Random House Audiobooks presents Eyes of a Child by Richard North Patterson. Read for you by Ken Howard. Eyes of a Child. Ricardo Arias's face filled with fear and disbelief. "If you're going to kill yourself," the intruder repeated softly, "you must leave a note." Richie's eyes would not move from the gun. Pulled from damp and darkness, it had not been fired for years. The intruder wondered if it would fire now. But Richie Arias did not know this. Sitting at his desk, Richie began groping for the pen. His face was thin, with black eyes that shifted from softness to anger, as suited his needs, and yet never quite lost the alert, almost fevered expression of a bright graduate student running on too much coffee and too little sleep. Blood had begun to trickle from one nostril. "I never write." His head twitched toward the computer on the desk. "Everyone knows I use that." "Suicide is different." The intruder's voice was strained now. "The handwriting must be yours." Richie's face looked drawn. Slowly, he picked up the pen, holding it gingerly. "I am ending my life," the intruder spoke for him, "because I have faced what I am." An instant's pause, the instinct to resist. Then Richie's pen began to inch across the paper. "What I am," the voice instructed him, "is selfish and pathetic." Wiping the blood from his nose, Richie stared at the paper. It was a moment before his hand moved, and when it did, there was a red smear on the back of his fingers. "My only business is extortion. I have used my wife and child out of greed and shamelessness because I myself am nothing." Richie flushed with anger. He stopped, staring at the words he had already written. His hand would not move. The intruder hesitated, irresolute, then saw on the bookshelf next to Richie a photograph. Gun aimed at Richie, the intruder retrieved the picture and placed it carefully on the desk. A dark-haired girl, her solemn brown eyes gazing at Richie Arias. It was far better than a note, the intruder realized. A last expression of cheap sentiment would seem so very like him. A shrine to his own suicide. "You see," the intruder said softly, "I know who you are." "You can just leave." Richie's tone became a shrill wheedle. "I won't tell anyone. We just let it go, okay?" All at once, staging a suicide did not matter. "Only you," the intruder said quietly, "would think that I could let it go. Only you." Richie's gaze darted to the gun. Slowly, the intruder started toward him. 5 feet, then four. The intruder stopped, raising the gun. "I'll give her up," Richie whispered. In silent answer, the intruder's head moved from side to side. Richie turned to run. The gun jerked up at his first panicky step. As he stretched forward, straining for the hallway, Richie's leg slammed into the coffee table. There was a sharp, sudden scream of pain. The next few seconds were like freeze frames. Richie snapping at the waist, arms flailing, sprawling forward in a face-first dive, head bobbing like a rag doll. Temple hitting the corner of the table. Another sound, a sickening crack. And then Ricardo Arias rolled sideways, flopping onto the carpet, and was still. He lay on his back, staring at the ceiling. Gun hand trembling, the intruder knelt beside him. There was a red gash on his temple. Blood dribbled from his nose. The luminous wristwatch on his arm read 10:36. Tentatively, almost gently, the intruder pushed open Richie's lips with the barrel of the gun. Eyes shut, the intruder took one breath and pulled the trigger. A metallic snap. The ancient gun had not discharged. Richie blinked, the first tremor of consciousness. His eyes widened in terrible comprehension. His head rose, twisting feebly. His mouth opened around the barrel to form a single word. Please. The child shuddered. It was dark. She was damp from the struggle to escape. Her legs could not move, and her voice could not cry out. Knees drawn up tight against her stomach, she lay there, waiting. As the door burst open, the little girl awakened with a soundless scream, torn from her nightmare. A shadow moved toward her. The girl shivered, stifling her scream, hugging herself so tightly that her fingers dug into her skin. And then her grandmother spoke softly in Spanish, and Elena Arias stopped trembling.
It was only your dream,
her grandmother repeated, and swept Elena into her arms.
You're safe now.
Where is Mommy?
Elena asked.
Your mother is still here, at her house. Tomorrow she's flying to a place called Italy, but she'll be back in 10 more days. And in the morning, when you wake up, we'll find Italy on the map again.
3 nights later, 6 months after they had first made love, Teresa Peralta found herself in Venice with Christopher Paget, astonished to be in Italy, fearful that their time together was coming to an end. Chris stood on the balcony of what had once been a 13th-century palazzo. He was dressed only in shorts, the late afternoon sun on his skin. From the living room of their suite at the Danieli, Terri watched him as she held the phone to her ear. Halfway around the world, Richie's telephone rang again. It was her third call in an hour. 10 rings later, Terri slowly put down the telephone. She was fresh from the shower, a slim, dark-haired young woman who barely came to Chris's shoulder, with olive skin and a sculpted face that he kept trying to persuade her was beautiful. A chiseled nose, too pronounced for her liking, high cheekbones, delicate chin, a quick smile that transformed her seriousness without ever quite changing her green-flecked brown eyes, watchful by habit. Chris gazed out of the Grand Canal, standing in the posture Terri had come to know, hands in his pockets, head tilted slightly, taking something in. She walked toward him, making no sound.
It's timeless, Chris said without turning. I don't know why exactly, but I take comfort in that.
As if we can survive Richie, after all. Terri was quiet for a moment.
How did you know I was here?
Because you're wearing almost nothing. It's a sixth sense I have. As Terri smiled, Chris turned to face her. He looked 10 years younger than he was. His face was barely lined, his coppery hair had no hint of gray, and Spartan self-discipline kept him trim and well-muscled. The ridged nose, a certain angularity, lent his features strength. But what struck Terri now was the startling blueness of his eyes, and the concern for her she saw there. His machine is off, she said. Chris's eyes narrowed. Perhaps they're out. No way.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.